To our feet, and we're going to sing praises to our God.
Break our day, and hope we rise. We speak your name, we lift our eyes, tune our hearts to your beat. Glory's breaking through the night. You will never fade away.
so great, it's so strong, and he just wants to surround us today in his amazing love.
I'm matched to know your wisdom and love.
Jesus. to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on the cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and God alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forever.
Psalm 95 Church says, come on everyone, let's sing for joy to the Lord. Let's shout our loudest praises to the God who saved us. Are you thankful to the God who has saved you? Are you thankful for your salvation this morning, that you have been redeemed, that you have been forgiven, that you have been given peace with God and eternal life with him? I want to share a praise report this morning that over the last 2 weeks we have seen over 14 people in our youth services on Sunday and our ministry days give their lives to Jesus. Come on, that's worth celebrating. There's a party going on in heaven. You know what? We serve a God who saves. He saves us sinners. He came into the world not to condemn but to save. And so I want to encourage us. Come on, let's lift our hands. Let's believe for more. Let's raise our faith and expectation. Let's declare that he is good. Come on, let's praise his name.
Praise the name. Oh, praise his
are drawing men and women and children to yourself. Jesus, we pray for more, that you'd raise our level of faith and expectation, Lord Jesus, to see more people come into the saving knowledge of Jesus. We thank you for salvation. Oh, our Savior, we're so grateful. Oh, Lord, thank you for your love for each one of us. Lord, we praise your name this morning. You are worthy of all our praise. Amen? Come on, let's give him a shout of praise this morning. Thank you, Jesus. You're so worthy to be praised. We love you this morning. Thank you, Father. Amen. Amen. So great. Why don't you turn around, welcome someone to church. Tell them they're looking fabulous this morning. Awesome. Thanks, team. Good morning. Welcome to Elam Christian Center North. We're our northernmost campus in Whangarei, and we are just so glad that you're here. My name is Amy, and my husband Mike and I are the campus pastors, and just really want to warmly welcome you on behalf of us and our team. We're so glad that you are here today. It's a great place to be on a Sunday. Yeah? Awesome. Well, we're going to do some celebrating. We love to give out gold on Sundays. And the gold is in a form of a crunchy bar. So if you've had a birthday or a wedding anniversary, something great to celebrate, please come forward. Don't be shy. And as you come forward, just want to let you know we've got great kids programs from One and Walking through to Voltage, our intermediate program. Power Zone today are starting a new series. In August, you need to go and check out what Cindy and the team have done, transformed the Power Zone room. It looks amazing. So we're so blessed to have just such amazing programs for our kids. So, Simi, start us off.
Celebrating my son's birthday. And also, I announced last week he's engaged, but they're also expecting a baby.
It's wonderful. Congratulations. Hello. Wow, this is very special. What are you celebrating?
My wife.
It's always a good day to celebrate your wife. You guys got married when?
2 weeks ago.
The most beautiful wedding. I actually live streamed it because I couldn't be there, and it was stunning. And it was at Mount Moniah. Is that right? The camp. And you built this amazing structure yourself. Am I right? Am I right? I hope so. It was just gorgeous, and congratulations. We're so happy for you both. Yay! Awesome. Wonderful. Great stuff. Well, look, if you are first time, it's your first time here at Elam visiting with us, we really want to welcome you. We're so glad that you're here, and we hope and pray that you just feel really at home with us today, and we don't want you to miss out. So we would love to give you a chocolate bar and some information about who we are as Elam, and just love to put that in your hand if you would like to receive one and you're visiting here, or maybe your friend who bought you can be brave enough. If you just give us a wave and we'll wander down the aisles and pop something in your hand down the front here. Welcome over here at the back. Amazing. So great to see so many visitors down there. Welcome. Come on, church. Let's welcome our visitors this morning. Down there. Hello. Welcome. We hope, just so glad that you're here. And we'd love to invite you to our guest lounge. It's in the middle of our foyer. We'd love to give you a coffee, something to eat, and just help you in any way we can. So, welcome. It's so great that you are here. Awesome. Well, just a few notices this morning. Many of you might have seen, but if you haven't, this is our new Connect card. And this really covers so many areas for you. Maybe you're a first-time visitor here today and you'd like us to stay in touch or give you a call. Maybe you made a decision to accept Jesus or recommit your life to him. We would love you to fill out one of these so we can help you on your journey. Maybe you would love to attend our growth track or join a small group. Or come on our dream team. They're really, really cool t-shirts, you'll see. So come and be a part of what God is doing here. If you'd like to be baptized, so many things. If you've moved, and we need to know your details. But also, can I just point out, if you have a prayer request, this is the form to fill in, and we would love to stand with you in prayer. And if you have a praise report telling us something great that God has done, please would you fill this out? Because we want to know, we want to celebrate with you. So that's our Connect card. You can check it out in the information area throughout the cafe. They should be should be there. Our growth track, one of the things I mentioned, is our four-week course, all about just knowing who Elam is and if you'd like to be a part of our church family here. And it begins today, but it's not too late. You can sign up next week. It rolls month by month, 4 weeks. It'll help you to know God. It'll help you to find freedom, discover your purpose, and make a difference. It will phenomenally change your world, this course. So we encourage everybody to do it. It's not too late if you want to start next week or jump on September's course. And lastly, I'd love to let you know that in 2 weeks' time, we have Excel School of Performing Arts coming to Elam. They're coming to Whanganui for the week. They'll be at our Youth Oxygen Service on the Friday night and at both morning services in 2 weeks' time on the 19th of August. So mark that date. You don't want to miss it. A great group of young people who travel New Zealand, given up a year to share the good news of Jesus. And they do it through music and dance and drama. And it's going to be amazing. So I encourage you to come out. And if possibly you've got a spare room in your home that you might be able to host a billet for a week, if you could see our youth pastor Jaden Hatch and help us out with that. I know our kids are really excited to host somebody. So yeah, that's coming up in a couple of weeks. Well, just as our team would like to come forward, just like to receive our tithes and offering this morning. And I'd love to read to you just a couple of scriptures in Matthew. And this is Matthew chapter 4. And it says, as Jesus was walking by the shore of Lake Galilee, he noticed two fishermen who were brothers. One was nicknamed Kepha. Did you know that's Aramaic for the rock? The Greek name you'll know him as maybe Peter. And his brother Andrew. And they were casting their nets, and Jesus called out to them and he said, come follow me, and I will transform you into men who catch people for God. How good is that? Immediately they dropped their nets and they left everything behind to follow Jesus. I'm so inspired by Peter and John just to do that. You know what? They were out with their livelihood, out in their boats, and Jesus called them and said, I want to make you fishers of men. And I just want to encourage you with a thought that Jesus will always use what you let, you will always fill what you let him use. He will always fill what you let him use. And, you know, for Peter and Andrew, that boat was their livelihood. That was their way of making an income. And Jesus said, will you give me that boat? Because, man, what I'm going to do is greater than what you could dare to dream and do by yourself. And I just want to encourage you that as you give, you know what? It's your finances. It's your time. It's your talents. That God will always fill what you let him use. So give your boats to Jesus. He won't ever let you down, won't fail to be all that you need. Amen. Well, Father God, I thank you for the privilege of giving our first and our best to you, Lord. I thank you, like Peter and Andrew, Father, we want to be those people that, Lord, just say, yes, use me. Use what I have. This, Lord, it doesn't seem a lot, but Lord, in your hands, it can do amazing things. And I pray that you would bless what is given, that it would multiply and, Lord, just achieve purposes in people's lives, freedom, salvation, ministering into our community and the nation more than we could dare to hope or dream. And so in Jesus' name, we pray this. Amen. Amen. So thank you, team, for your faithful giving as we receive this morning. If you're here visiting, please just let the buckets go by. But we really, truly have a faithful and generous church, and we love you guys. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce my husband, Mike. We're starting a new series today, and it's called You Asked For It. We did this series last year, and it was a highlight series in our year. This is where you got to ask, what would you like to hear in church? And so, over to you, darling.
Fantastic. Come on, can we just honour our volunteers that serve, our worship team, our production team at the back, our dream team that are serving us week in, week out, our kids team, just amazing. We love this family. So this morning we start our new series, You Asked For It. You've asked the questions. We are going to do our very best to answer the questions you have asked. And so this morning I'm looking at the question which has been asked last year and also this year, should church and politics mix? All right, anyone need to leave or are we all right to carry on with this one? I think this is an important one we need to engage in. What's our response as Christians when it comes to politics? So would you pray with me? I feel like I'm going to need a little bit of God's help this morning as I bring some, hopefully some clarity around this topic. God, I thank you so much that you give us the wisdom that we need. Thank you that you've given us your word. It's a lamp to our feet, a light to our path. Lord, as we look at your word today, as we look to answer this question, Lord, what is our response when it comes to things in government and politics? Lord, how are we to engage? What are we to do? God, I pray you just give each person, Lord, a personal revelation, a personal understanding of what we are to do. God, I thank you, Lord, you love this nation. Lord, we sing that you will defend this nation. And God, we continue to speak that over this place. We thank you for the government in our nation. We're so thankful, Lord, that we live in the society we do. Lord, thank you for the foundation of this nation that was built on the principles of your word. And Lord, I pray we would take our responsibility seriously, Lord, to pray for and lift up and support this government in Jesus' name. Everyone said? Amen, amen. Well, in this room, there's probably three groups of people, three different types of people when it comes to this whole era of politics. Some of you, you've already switched off. I mean, you've already half asleep. You know, it's time to wake up now, right? Politics does not interest you at all. You're quite happy just to completely disengage. The elections come by. You will do everything you can not to engage in politics. That's kind of one group of people. Then you've got another group of people who are so passionate about it, they often get themselves into trouble by being so passionately driven and motivated by their political views. They want to debate it, want to talk about it, very, very passionate about it. And you've got another group of people, which might actually include probably many more, which are not sure how to engage, not sure what my responsibility is. Do I vote? Do I not vote? Which party do I vote for? Who do I actually go and support? What is my responsibility as a Christian when it comes to this? So I've loosely kind of put everybody in three different categories, but we'd probably find ourselves somewhere in one of those. What is our response? What are we supposed to do? Now, we are a free nation in the sense that my vote actually makes a difference in terms of the government that could be ruling over me. I have an opportunity to present my tick on a piece of paper to say, this is the government I would like to have lead me. Now, if a lot of people agree with me, my government gets put in place. True? Our government. Right. So we have this opportunity, an incredible responsibility to be able to vote for the people that would lead us. But with that privilege also comes the responsibility. Our voice, our vote can make a difference. We have an incredible nation when there's so many nations that are struggling in the political realm, where there's corruption, where there's the inability for people to actually make a vote that actually counts. Their voice actually doesn't matter and is not actually listened to or responded to. And so we are in an incredible nation. But the challenge is, how do we respond? Some questions that we might ask. What laws apply to me? God's laws or the law of the land? What do we do in that situation? As a Christian, am I exempt from some laws that are made in our nation? Which leader do I choose? Which political party gets my vote? Should I even bother voting? Now, this morning I want to kind of try and give a biblical summary of what our response should be in terms of politics. And just to make it clear from the outset, I will not be telling you who to vote for. I will not be telling you which political party I support. If you want to have a conversation with me, we can have a conversation over a cup of tea, coffee, no problem. But it's not my place to put forward a political party for you to respond to or vote to. What I am talking about is a government that leads us, that rules over us, whether it be blue, red, green, black, orange, pink. We have a responsibility as Christians to support and to pray for our nation. So I want to lay the foundation of this message with the Word of God. It's where we go to for our understanding. It's where we go to for truth, for knowledge, for the way we want to build our lives. And two passages. One talks about the government authority over us, and then the other talks about spiritual authority over us. And I believe the two need to go hand in hand. That leadership and submitting to authority, whether it be spiritual or just a natural government over us, I think our response still needs to be the same. So let's read Romans chapter 13. Paul's talking to the people of Rome. Rome was the center of power in the globe. So it was one of the most powerful places in the whole world. And so Paul's talking to the church in Rome, and he's giving an address. In the 12th chapter, he starts talking about love. What does love look like? How do we express love? And then he goes straight in. Remember, there were no numbers in the actual letters that were written. It was just one paragraph to the next. So after talking about love, Paul goes straight on to chapter 13 and he says, obey the government, for God is the one who has put it there. There is no government anywhere that God has not placed in power. I know that's hard to believe, but God's hand is on every government that is formed across the globe. So those who refuse to obey the laws of the land are refusing to obey God, and punishment will follow. Driving 120 kilometers in a 100k speed zone. Feel the Holy Spirit moving in this place. Conviction coming upon people. Come on, nudge the guilty party. If that's someone, you know. I'm just teasing. Or am I? Hebrews 13, verse 17. Obey your spiritual leaders and be willing to do what they say. For their work is to watch over your souls, and God will judge them on how well they do this. We're not to judge them. God does the judging. Give them reason to report joyfully about you to the Lord and not with sorrow, for then you will suffer for it too. Our natural leaders in government, but also our spiritual leaders, we're to honor them, we're to respect them, to serve under them. I've had numerous conversations over the years with people around politics and government, and people want to complain about the government and how the government's not doing this and the government's not doing that. And sometimes I ask the question, hey, did you vote at the last election? No, I didn't vote. And I say, well, respectfully, I'm not sure that you actually get to have an opinion then. If you're not prepared to engage in the process that will form our nation, I'm not sure that your opinion actually matters too much to me. But if you're prepared to vote, then we can at least have a conversation around it. How does that sound? So, yeah, got to say it sometimes, huh? You'll be amazed at the response, I didn't vote because I didn't like anyone, so therefore no vote. Okay, yep. Or I didn't vote because Romans says that God chooses the government. It's through our tick. He uses us. God sees the world saved through his people who will go out and share the good news. It's important we engage in the process in government and also in seeing people find the good news. I'll just read it again in the NIV version, Romans 12:1. Let everyone be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. So Paul the Apostle is telling us that our first response is to submit to the governing authorities above us. Now, if you are a student, you respond to the authority of your teachers. If you are a teacher, you respond to the authority of the HOD. If you're an HOD, you respond to the authority of your principal. The principal responds to the principal's association. Then you see what happens? There's this coming under the authority in business. It doesn't matter what position you find yourself in, you are under an authority. There is authority that we operate under which protects us with laws that help guide us and help shape how we do business, how we do relationships. And these are biblical foundations that actually God laid in this nation. We are a Christian nation. Now, we want to return back to the roots of that. We want to see more and more of God's heart poured out for people in this nation. And we've got to continue to pray. We've got to continue to engage in the process to make sure that this remains a Christian nation. I'm speaking that in faith. I'm not saying everybody's believing that. But the laws, the song, the nation, the national anthem we sing is declaring that God will protect this nation. But will we engage in the prayer that would see this nation changed? Let me ask a few questions that maybe you or I have asked, and I've asked these questions when it comes to submitting or serving somebody in leadership over me. What if I don't like them? Good question, right? What if I don't like the person who's leading me? What if I don't like the political party that's in charge? What if I don't like the person who's the prime minister or the deputy prime minister? What if I don't like them? Second question, what if their values and my values are different? Third question, what if they're asking me to do something, if the law is asking me to do something that is completely against what God says and his law? Now, the second two questions are a little bit harder to answer than the first one. Let's tackle the first one. What if I don't like the person who's in charge of me? I don't have to like someone to submit to their position. God puts a position in authority over us. The prime minister, the local government. It is a position, not so much a person. Because that person may change and will change. We don't have the same person forever. The position is what God has instituted, and he has also put the person in there. So we have to respect and honor the person and also the position. Really important that we engage in that, make sure that we make that commitment, that we don't necessarily have to like them, but I've found it easier to actually work with someone if I like them. Yeah? Don't you find that? It's so much easier to hang out with someone if you actually like them. And so what I'm learning to do, and I've learned to do over the years, is when I'm struggling to like someone, and believe it or not, there are people in the world that are not as easy to like as others. And so I'm probably one of them. You're looking at me, I know, Mike, you're one of them. So I made a decision that I will do all I can to position my heart in a place where I can actually like people as well. Not just respect them for who they are and what they do, but I want to position my heart in a way that I would actually like them. Because I think the journey's so much cooler if you actually like the people you're with, and the people you work with, and the people you serve under. God taught me a very valuable lesson. I was working in Power Zone. We were running the kids program. We'd be up at 6 a.m. laying out stages for 3 services that were about to happen. And so we had hundreds of kids coming in. And so I needed help. I needed some teenagers, volunteers to come. And so they were coming and they'd help me set up. And there was this boy, Tim. He was about 14 years old when he first started coming. He says, I can help, Mike. I'm going to be real helpful for you. And I'm like, that's great. I wasn't so convinced that he'd be helpful. But he came along and he offered his help, but he wasn't really that helpful. He said, I'll take care of all the tech stuff. And so he'd be plugging the wrong cords into the wrong places. And so he would be setting up what he thought was a complete system. And then we would kind of get to the start of the service and we're going, why is that not working? And we're moving things and trying to change things. I got frustrated with Tim. In fact, I saw him coming to help. But the next Sunday, I go, I don't want him to come. And I got frustrated with Tim. And I started to say bad things about Tim. I started to feel things in my heart towards Tim that weren't good things. And I was praying the good Christian prayer, improve or remove, God. Improve or remove. Improve or remove. And I felt like God say, improve who, Mike? You mean there's a work that's got to go on in my life, God? It's not him. And I felt God say, well, why don't you pray for him? Why don't you love him? Here's this guy offering his service free of charge, a volunteer coming, wanting to help. And you're upset and frustrated with him. I'm like, oh, sorry, God. So I did. I began to pray for him. Began to love him. He didn't have a dad in his life. I might have been one of the few male figures in his life as a role model. And how was I treating him? Probably not so good. So I just said, God, help me. So I began to love this guy. I began to just speak into his life. And we began to train him so he could get better at it. And believe it or not, he got better. He improved. And he actually, I kind of see him coming and going, oh, cool, it's Tim. And it's like, oh, something shifted in my heart. Then about 2 weeks later, he comes to me and says, we're moving to Australia. After 3 years. It took me 3 years to finally like this guy. And God says, right, thanks, Mike. You finally learned your lesson. Now I can move him on. Yeah. But something had to shift. How did it shift? Not just by having good feelings. I said, God bless him. God, draw him closer to you. God, may he know your presence. May he know your peace. May he know his identity in you. All the words of rejection that have been spoken over his life from male figures in his life. Dad walked out on him and rejected him. God, we just want to see a change in that. I began to speak and pray that over his life, and something shifted. Prayer is powerful. How many people believe that prayer can change things? It's the one weapon we have that no one can take away from us. It's the one thing we can do that can actually make a difference, because we call upon a powerful name that can change things in people's lives. So we must remember, number one, their appointment has been established by God. Number two, our submission to their leadership has also been established by God. Sometimes we can recognize that God is the authority and that God's put them in authority, but our submission is actually ordained by God as well. God has asked us to submit to the authority above us. So when I say I don't want to submit to that leader or that government or that political party, I'm effectively saying to God, I will not submit to you. That's the reality of it. That's a big statement to be making to God, our Creator, the one we love and serve, to say, actually, this person, I won't submit to them. God, I won't submit to you. Let's not find ourselves in that place. Let's make a commitment to pray. So the first one, what if I like them or don't like them? Well, actually, we can combat that with prayer, right? We can actually get a heart for somebody and begin to love them. Begin to pray for our Prime Minister and the Deputy Prime Minister and pray for the opposition leader. Pray for the political parties and ask God to give you a heart for them. Don't necessarily have to be their best friend. It's probably not going to happen. But you could still love them and still get a heart for them. But what if I disagree or they disagree with the values that God's placed? When I open God's word and it completely is contradicting what this law has now been passed. We've seen that in our nation, right? We've seen some things shift. We've seen some decisions made, some votes that have been cast that are actually out of line with what God says. Now, this is where it gets difficult. But are we allowed to engage in difficult? I think we need to. And I think when Christians actually make a decision to engage in the difficult, but do it with honor, with integrity, with love, the shining light, the example, actually makes a difference in our world. People see the way we respond in difficult times, and God gets glory because of it. So let's engage in the difficult, and let's look at some examples from the Bible of men and women who made a decision to be faithful to God and also honor the authority that was above them. Queen Esther, a young queen, she broke all protocol when she approached the king because her people, the Israelite people, were about to be destroyed. Esther broke all of it. She went into his presence unannounced. She wasn't even supposed to be there. She could have lost her life. He was that kind of a king that he could have just killed her on the spot. I'll get a new queen, thank you. But Esther boldly approached him because there was something that was wrong in the kingdom. And so she stepped in and she brought truth with love, with honor, with wisdom, with respect. And God provided for her and protected her. Daniel, another young man, brought into captivity. Out of his comfort zone, he was in a land that he didn't even want to be in, and yet he lived a life of integrity, so much so that he was put in an incredible position. And we're going to read from Daniel 6 this morning. Verse 1, it says, It pleased Darius to appoint 120 satraps to rule throughout the kingdom, with three administrators over them, one of whom was Daniel. The satraps were made accountable to them so that the king might not suffer loss. Now Daniel so distinguished himself among the administrators and the satraps by his exceptional qualities that the king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. Young people, don't push your case forward by losing your integrity. Remain integrous in all you do. Remain the discipline. Yeah, stay disciplined. Keep doing what you've been asked to do. Be faithful in it. Turn up early. Leave late. Be faithful in what you do, and God will see that. And your leaders will see that. They see when you're not doing it right. They see when you're slacking. They also see when you're achieving. Don't worry about the promotion. That'll come when the time's right. Don't chase the promotion. Follow after God's heart and his integrity. Love him and love people, and you watch what God does. He'll raise you up at exactly the right time. He won't raise you up before it's to the right time. Because if you get raised up too early, you might not be able to handle it. God might be doing a work of character, and I just feel like this is a word for somebody. God might be doing a work of character in your life. You're not ready for the next step, but you will be. But you've got to go through this journey of being faithful where you're at right now. Be faithful there, and one day God's going to go, he's going to surprise you. Oh, there it is. Don't chase it. Don't go looking for it. God will put you in the right place. That was Daniel. He just lived an exceptional life with exceptional qualities. It says, at this, the administrators and the satraps tried to find grounds for charges against Daniel and his conduct of government affairs. A few jealous people. Anyone ever come across that in the workplace? Somebody jealous of what you do? But they were unable to do so. They couldn't find a fault in Daniel. They could find no corruption in him because he was trustworthy and neither corrupt nor negligent. Finally, these men said, we will never find any basis for charges against this man, Daniel, unless it has something to do with the law of his God. I find this such a fascinating passage of Scripture. They couldn't find anything wrong with Daniel because he upheld the law of the land. He was so faithful to what had been set over him. Even though he didn't necessarily agree with everything, he was faithful. And so they set up a trap. They said, the only way we're going to get this guy is if we set up a law in the land that will compromise his faithfulness to God. So they set up this trap and they said, right, we're going to get him to have to choose between bowing down to the king and worshiping the king or worshiping God. And they knew that Daniel was committed to God above the law of the land. So they set him up. So this is a response. These administrators and satraps went as a group to the king and said, may King Darius live forever. What a bunch of suck-ups, seriously. I mean, come on. Oh, King felt, yes, I will live forever. Thank you for your encouragement. The royal administrators, prefects, satraps, advisors, and governors, all except Daniel, that part wasn't in there, have all agreed that the king should issue an edict and enforce the decree that anyone who prays to any god or human being during the next 30 days, except to you, your majesty, shall be thrown into the lion's den. Great punishment, that one. Now, your majesty, issue the decree and put it in writing so that it cannot be altered, in accordance with the law of the Medes and Persians, which cannot be repealed. So King Darius put the decree in writing. Now when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went home to his upstairs room where the windows opened toward Jerusalem. Three times a day he got down on his knees and prayed, giving thanks to his God, just as he had done before. Daniel heard the news about the new law and goes and immediately breaks it. Was Daniel right in doing so? Big question. Did he give us permission to break civil law? It's kind of a big question, isn't it? Is this permission given to go against the government? But in order for Daniel to obey the king's law, he first of all had to break God's law. In order to keep the laws of the land, Daniel would have to break the laws of his God. This is where it gets interesting. This is where it gets difficult when we have to make a decision, will I honor a law which is greater than the law of the land? God's law. Yes, we have a nation that is built on God's principles, but we are straying. We're moving from the way God would intend it to be. If we stay true to his word, nothing would move, right? Because it doesn't move. But our nation is moving, and we're following the nations of the world, wrestling against God, saying we think we know better. But God's law stands, and sometimes we might have to stand. One day I might have to find myself in that difficult situation where I'm going to have to go against the law of the land because God's law is higher than that. I don't know what will happen in that situation, but I do know that I want to uphold God's law more than I want to uphold what the people think. Tough decision. Now, I never want to disregard or disrespect authority, but God's standards are higher than man's standards. And when we move away from it, we face the consequences of that as a nation. One of our lead pastors was sharing, you know, that there's nations that are not like our nation. There's difficult challenges. You know, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they were in the same situation as Daniel. In order to fulfill the king's command, which was to bow down to the statue that he'd made, they would have to break the first three commandments of the law, of God's law. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not have any idols. Even you shall not misuse the Lord's name, or you shall not blaspheme. Because he would have had to speak out the name of the king and worship over God. So he would have been committed to breaking three of God's commandments. And what did they do? What was their response? You know, in strict atheistic regimes or nations where Islamic or communist rule is in place, this is a greater challenge. Some laws in Bangladesh, I've been talking with Sukhan, my friend over in Bangladesh, they are completely anti-Christ in nature, meaning they are opposed to Christ, opposed to Christian living. Some of those decisions, the laws that are made in some of these nations, if you fight against it, you can lose your life, certainly imprisoned. In fact, he shared with me moments that, please pray. There was a mob was coming after one of his team, because this man was leading children to Jesus. And so this mob was coming after them. Could have taken their lives. Didn't. The man was protected. Praise God for that. But the reality is, sometimes when we have to make a stand for God, we lose everything, including our own lives. I was talking with one of our lead pastors, and there's a church in Pakistan. Two of the church members just lost their lives because of their faith in Jesus. They've committed their lives to following Jesus. As a result of that, they were killed. The pastor and the elders were sitting around a table, very somber moment. One of them turns to the other and says, "We'll probably lose our lives for this, right?" Kind of an acknowledgement, a nod of their heads, and went, "Okay," and carried on with church business. That's the cost of following Jesus, my friends. You know, we live in a nation where that persecution isn't as extreme as maybe you feel, but maybe there's going to come a day where we're going to have to make a stand on God's laws and choose God's laws above the laws that have been set that are opposed to God's laws. A higher stand. This is where it gets difficult, but it's important. We need to take a moment to count our blessing. This is a good nation. We have a great political system. We should be thankful for that. Shouldn't criticize it as much as we do. Let's be thankful for the fact that most of the laws that are built in this country are built on the principles of God. It was established under biblical principles. So when it starts to move, let's just pray. Let's just pray. Let's do something about it. Let's not let it slide. Let's do something about it. Daniel's decision to pray was based on the first and second commandments, which overrode the law of the land of the king. But it was also confirmed by supernatural protection. So Daniel made the decision to stand, and God protected him by closing the mouth of the lions. Now, the lions that were there to devour him, they didn't even touch him because God protected him. Same could be said about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They were told that they would be thrown into a fiery furnace if they didn't bow down to the statue. So what do you do in that decision? In that moment, how do you respond? Do you bow your knee to the pressure? Or do you stay on the conviction? See, I don't think they just had wonderful, you know, goosebump moments there. You know, I've just got this feeling that I should do this. Yes, they would have felt the presence of God. I am 100% certain the power of God would have come upon them in that moment. But I reckon their decision was made based on the truth of God's word that they knew in their hearts. And we've got to make our convictions. Our convictions have got to be based on God's word. Listen to this. These are some of the promises I reckon that they would have had. Psalm 34:19, the righteous person may have many troubles, like being thrown into a fiery furnace, but the Lord delivers him or her from them all. There's a good promise right there. Do you think when the king says, you know, come on, you're going to be thrown into a fiery furnace, what do you think their response would have been? I reckon Rakshak and Benny, they would have been on their feet saying, you know what, king, you can throw us into that fiery furnace and God will save us. And then they go, and even if he doesn't, meaning, hey, we realize that we're fully committed to this, regardless of whether we get saved or not. Even if he doesn't, king, we ain't bowing down. We're not going to bow down, because that would go against our conviction, which is we will have no other gods before us. God is the only true God. Difficult, but important. I bet they knew Isaiah 43:2. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. So I wonder if in that moment, they're standing there, Shadrach nudges the boys, hey, get the playlist out on your iPhone. Let's hit that 1987 classic, Phil Pringle. Fear not, for I am with you. Fear not, for I am with you. Fear not. For I am with you, says the Lord. Come on, I want to hear some of these 70s, 80s singers. I have redeemed you, I have called you by name. Child, you are mine. Click along, millennials. When you walk through the waters, I'll be there. And through the flames, come on. You'll not be drowned. You'll not be burned. For I am with you. Fear not.
All right, show's over.
They knew the word of God, and they would not bow down. They would not bow down. Not bow down to the pressure. God's word stood stronger. So where do we stand as we bring it to a close? If the team can join me now. There's three practical things I believe we can do when it comes to engaging in politics and government. What is our response as Christians? Because there are opportunities, there's moments when the government will present something to us where we get to have a voice. What do we do in those moments? I believe we get involved. We got to get involved. And here's how we're going to do it. Number one, pray and vote. Pray and vote. Don't have an opinion if you're not prepared to put a vote in. Amy and I, we pray about our decision. I think we've actually voted for different parties at different times. Strange. Yeah, woo, imagine that, dividing a family. But we prayed, and we're asking God for conviction personally. My decision is not one I can sway on anybody else. This is me, my relationship with God. And yes, have a conversation and talk about it. But what am I voting for? I'm voting for a political party that's going to lead us closer to God, to a nation that would honor His word. I'm praying for a political party that's going to honor family, because that's what matters to me the most. Families, whole families, families together, family strength, and families provided with everything they need, health and welfare and all of those things. This is what I make my decisions on. Now, you've got to come to that conviction yourself. Who are you voting for? So we pray and we vote. Next time it comes around, make sure you get there. Do you know how many people don't turn up and vote that could? It's frightening that we have an opportunity to have a voice, and there are a lot of Christians that don't vote. Can I encourage you, put a vote in, ask God for wisdom and vote for someone. Secondly, pray and honor. Pray and honor. Let's not talk down our leaders. I made that mistake last year. Something off my notes, you know, a good tip, stick to your notes, Mike, serves you better. I made a little gaffe, tried to be humorous and at the expense of a world leader. Immediately I felt the conviction of the Holy Spirit. Don't do that. That's wrong. I had to come and stand back before you the next week and say, guys, I'm sorry. Please forgive me. I have no right to talk down a leader. No right to criticize somebody in authority. They're going to get judged for whatever they do. I'm going to get judged for what I do. But we don't criticize. We honor our leaders. I love it. Paul, he's been talking about love in the 12th chapter of Romans, and then he goes into this passage in honoring the governing authority above us. But before he goes there, this is what he says. He says, let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another, for whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. Whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. Let our language and our response be love. When we love others, we actually fulfill the law of God. And thirdly, pray and get involved. I believe God is raising up a new generation of leaders, of Daniels, of Esthers, of Shadrachs, Meshachs, and Abednegos, who are going to say, you know what, I want to make a difference in governing this nation, leading this nation, politics and law and civil action and justice. God is raising up a generation, and at the close of the service, our ministry team would love to pray with you, speak into your life, help you as you say, yes, I want to make a difference. I don't want to just be this voice that isn't heard. I want my voice to be heard. I want the word of God to be spoken in these particular situations. What's the greatest thing we can do for our government? Have I made it clear enough yet? Pray, 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 pray and vote, pray and honor, pray and get involved. When we have the opportunity, we've got to take the opportunity. And right now, we're going to pray for our government. Is that good? And pray for our government. We're going to pray a prayer that's been prayed in Parliament. Now there's this thing out there trying to, and there's a particular name, the name of Jesus has been taken out of the prayer of Parliament, but we can pray the name of Jesus, because I don't see any point in praying a prayer where it doesn't point to someone or to an authority or a power that will actually make that prayer become a reality. Amen? So we stand under the name of Jesus. Every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord one day. So when we pray in the name of Jesus, we pray not in our power, not in our feelings, not in our emotions, but in the powerful name of Jesus Christ, which changes things, can change a nation. I'm watching in Bangladesh as there's this light that's starting to shine. We're seeing thousands, tens of thousands of children give their lives to Christ. There's a generation rising up that has seen the light, seeing Jesus, the name of Jesus, greater than every other name. So would you stand on your feet? We're going to pray this prayer together, and then we're going to sing our national anthem as worship. Let's not sing it like a rugby game or a sports field. Let's sing it as worship, because these words are worship to God. Let's engage in this with all of our heart. So let's pray this prayer together. Almighty God, humbly acknowledging our need for thy guidance in all things and laying aside all private and personal interests, we beseech thee to grant that we may conduct the affairs of this house and of our country to the glory of thy holy name, the maintenance of true religion and justice, the honor of the Queen, and the public welfare, peace, and tranquility of New Zealand through Jesus Christ our Lord. Come on, why don't you give God a shout of praise in this place? Why don't we lift up a song, a nation defended by God? So come on, with all of our voice, why don't we sing together? Right now, we pray for our nation. Lord, we pray for our Prime Minister. We pray for Jacinda Ardern. We pray for Winston Peters, for Simon Bridges. Lord, for all the politicians making decisions. God, I pray, Lord, where there is unity, Lord, you command a blessing. God, I pray, Lord, they wouldn't think of themselves in opposition, but Lord, together, building a nation together. God, I pray there'll be a shift in Parliament, Lord, as they come together on the things that they can agree on. Lord, that they wouldn't be against each other, but Lord, they would agree on family and caring for family and caring for people and the needs and the well-being of people. God, I pray, Lord, you would turn our hearts. Lord, if we have anger or frustration or we've grumbled or complained, Lord, may our grumbling turn to prayer. May our complaints turn to prayer. Lord, may we lift up those in leadership above us. Lord, wherever we find ourselves in government and politics, wherever it is, may we pray for those in leadership over us in Jesus' name. You know, I was thinking if all my grumbling was instead turned into prayer, how much richer would my prayer life be? Just me? If I prayed as much as I complained, I think my prayer life would be a whole lot richer. Come on, why don't we turn those complaints into some real prayer? Amen? Hey, you might be here today and we're talking about a God, submitting to a God, loving a God that loves us. And you've never made that decision to follow Christ Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You've never surrendered your life to Him. You've never walked with Him. Today we want to give you that opportunity as we close our service. God loves you. He has a plan and a purpose for your life. He sent His Son Jesus to come and live as a man, to experience every temptation, every struggle we would face. And ultimately, He died on a cross, a death that He didn't deserve, but we did. Why did He do that? He did that because that was the only way that man would be free from sin. And God has made a way for us to be right with Him, and it is through His Son Jesus. He's done all the work. Jesus died on the cross so that we wouldn't have to. But our response is we choose Him. We choose to respond to His love, to His grace. We want to extend that to every person here today. We don't want anyone to go out these doors not being in relationship with God. And I'm going to pray a prayer in a moment. And I'm inviting all of us to pray it together as a church family. And maybe for the very first time, or you're coming back to God, you're going to pray this prayer. God, stir in your heart right now. Would you respond? Would you respond and say, God, I don't have all the answers, but I'm going to trust you. Would you pray this prayer with me? Heavenly Father, thank you for sending your Son Jesus to die on the cross for me. Jesus, please forgive me for living life my own way. I need your forgiveness. I need you to make me clean. I choose to follow you for all the days of my life. Thank you for your grace, and thank you for salvation. In Jesus' name. If you're here today and you're praying this prayer as a response, maybe coming back to God, maybe for the very first time you're saying, I'm surrendering my life to Jesus. We want to connect with you after the service. We want to help you grow in your journey. If that's you, we've got a team at the back that's just going to spot your hand if you would be brave enough to slip it up right now. So that's me. I pray that prayer for the first time, or maybe I'm coming back to God again. Is there anyone here today praying that prayer for the first time, coming back to God again? God, I thank you, Lord, for hearts that have responded. Lord, people that are turning their lives back to you. God, give them courage to go and talk to someone about this decision, this prayer that they've prayed. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, we're going to close with one more song. A King who is forever, over every nation. Come on, why don't we declare it one more time?
Almighty God, we lift you high.
social justice, our team would love to pray for you specifically. So come forward, don't be shy. We've got tea and coffee in our cafe open. Grab an invite card, invite someone to church, invite someone to Excel in a couple of weeks. May God bless you. May He keep you. May His face shine upon you and give you peace. Amen. God bless. That's the end of our service. We'll see you next week.
You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift You higher. You are the only King forever.
Everyone.